So the unplanned videos have benefits, and the unplanned videos have drawbacks. Definitely was not planning on doing this kind of video this morning, but it's happening. I'm also not even sure how to categorize this video. I will probably wind up categorizing it as a thinking of playing video. For Iron Cross, man-to-man combat on the Eastern Front, 1941-42, from Strategy and Tactics number 132. So that's going back quite a ways. Number 132 is listed as from January, February 1990. January, February 1990. Wow, that makes it an old game now. I also know from the get-go that this is a particular type of thinking of playing video because this is really interconnected. My thinking of playing this game is interconnected with a lot more thinking about war game design at the squad and below scale. So in that sense, this video will also be somewhat of a continuation of some earlier videos on war game design. So, Iron Cross man-to-man combat on the Eastern Front. So, individual scale war games. Let me first of all say up front, I have not played a single individual scale war game ever. So when I get to Iron Cross, this may be my first individual scale combat game, hex encounter game. The individual scale, frankly, has never captured me very significantly. Morning coffee. And this is my thinking on that. The individual is a particular unit of analysis, and your organizations are a different unit of analysis. And first of all, I don't think that they really, I don't think that you go straight to an organizational level of analysis extrapolating from the individual. And likewise, I don't think you can extrapolate too much from the organizational level of analysis down to the individual. So, anyways, two distinct units of analysis. And needless to say, our overwhelming majority, I'm thinking, of the history of our game designing for tabletop, especially paper hex encounter war games, has focused on organizational unit of analysis, or focused on organizations. And incidentally, that makes perfect sense considering that militaries are fundamentally about organization, among other things. Warfare is organized violence. Combat is organized violence, and armies, of course, are organizations designed for combat and warfare. So, understandable. But then I guess, there's along the way we've had some individual scale games. I guess really only a handful really stand out, I guess, for this scale. I'm not even sure Iron Cross would make that, let's say, top five list. Actually, I doubt it would make the top five list, but I don't think there's that many individual scale war games, so I think Iron Cross would make, the list. I guess that's obvious. What I mean is, I think a list of individual scale war games to play, I think Iron Cross would make that list. Now, the individual, so what I'm emphasizing here is I think Restart. When I say the evolution of game design, we have developed all sorts of different mechanics to model organizational behavior. I don't think much has been done in the tabletop paper hex and counter format for developing mechanics to model the individual. Now, I think possibly, let's just say I would not be surprised if in the miniatures format, more progress has been made. But I just don't think much. Now, of course, that's going to be the fun thing for me to delve into Iron Cross if it is my first individual scale war game, because there is a bit of breaking into new territory for me. And, you know, maybe, well, actually, I'm sure these impressions will change. These are all impressions made prior to actually getting into my first individual scale war game. But I do think modeling individual behavior is probably where the computer came in. Computer power, you know, computing power comes in. And so I think maybe the Close Combat series, which was hugely successful, I think, as a computer war game. I think if I remember correctly, haven't looked at that series for quite a long time, but I think Close Combat, which was very successful overall, I think they advertised themselves as modeling to the individual level. Now, I guess it doesn't follow that the games were so popular because they successfully modeled at the individual level, but it just, at least it makes sense to at least think that with the power of, you know, the microprocessor, you could get some both viable and interesting individual modeling. Okay, that's that. So Iron Cross, man-to-man combat, Eastern Front. The introduction, very brief introduction. Iron Cross is a man-to-man war game covering infantry battles on a tactical level between German and Soviet forces in Russia during 1941-42. Now, this gives me an opportunity to talk about infantry battles. I am just much, much, much more interested in infantry fighting than mechanized fighting. Well, actually not even, I can't even say mechanized. I would say tank or armored fighting vehicle battles or combat. And that comes out in spades in my wargaming. I enjoy ASL-SK a lot and have no significant interest in getting into vehicles. I like the infantry modeling. That's what it really comes down to. I like the infantry modeling. So if Iron Cross really does focus on infantry battles, that'll be interesting for me. Oops, I forgot to say something about the individual scale. And I talked about developing mechanics, war game design, and war game mechanics. Granted, it is a focus, a matter of focus, right? So many games, not many, games can have aspects of individual modeling. So I guess you could say individual leaders in ASL-SK, ASL, individual leaders in Advanced Tobruk System. While the focus is still on organizations, organizational behavior. So I imagine here, individual scale combat in Iron Cross, I imagine the focus is going to be at the individual scale. I'm just interested in thinking, having not even, you know, broken open the rules here. I'm interested to see how the focus, I guess what I'm saying is I'm interested in seeing how the focus is put on the individual. Yeah. So, and infantry. So if there really is an infantry focus here, I'll be very interested to see. And again, it's a matter of, for me, how games focus on the infantry. Why am I emphasizing this? I will go so far as to say that for me, here's a funny observation. I find it slightly humorous that detailed small unit combat games have individual counters representing an implement of war like a machine gun, a flamethrower, whatever, a demolition charge. Individual counters for this. And yet, vehicles do not have a modeled crew. Not that I'm aware of, anyways. Again, this is not that I'm aware of. I think that there is, what I'm getting at is that I don't expect my games at this scale to have individual counters for a weapon, for a machine gun. If individual weapons as counters were brought in, and I don't know this, but if they were brought in just to facilitate rules for jamming, dropping, picking up, then I'm not impressed with that design choice. Again, what I'm getting at, I just don't expect individual counters for these pieces of weaponry. Whereas I actually do expect the crew of the tank. Conversely, I do expect the crew of the tank to be modeled separately, individually. And here's why. If I'm a Soviet soldier on the Eastern Front here, and I'm, you know, facing off, not by myself, of course, but if I'm facing off four advancing or three advancing, Panzer IVs, whatever, tanks, four German tanks, and they're coming at me, the capabilities are entirely inherent on the crew. Capabilities are inherent in what is modeled usually, and that's, you know, gun characteristics and ammunition characteristics and so forth. The capacity is entirely, not entirely, is fundamentally based on the crew. And so, how deadly, so if I just, if I'm looking at three German tanks coming, advancing towards me, and then I focus on one of those tanks, how deadly that unit, I mean, I guess you can call the tank a unit, although it's not the tank that's the unit, it's the tank and the crew that's the unit. How deadly that unit is fundamentally based on crew capability. And somehow I expect that to be modeled. I know that may scream fiddly. I don't know. Don't really care, frankly, because we accept fiddliness in all sorts of different areas. So this again goes to a focus. For example, I don't need fiddliness for even unjamming weapons. That's an interesting concept, by the way, unjamming weapons in a game that's supposed to represent 12 to 15 minutes, or is it even that much? Unjamming, anyways. We accept fiddliness in all sorts of areas. I would rather take fiddliness out of some areas that are generally accepted and put it onto some other areas. Again, that's a comment I've mentioned before, So now, incidentally, I believe, and I'm going to say I believe because I've only heard about it and read about it. I don't have the game rules in question, so make a declarative statement here, but I believe that there is a well-received and popular rule set, miniatures rule set, that models the cruise. So I'm not implying that it hasn't been done and no one does it or whatever, but it's just so patently obvious to me that the crew is modeled. It's the crew that needs to be modeled. A tank just, you know, again, expands on the capabilities of the crew. But anyways, should be a pretty obvious idea. And you know, the other reason why this concept is so ingrained in my mind is thinking back to some training experience in Germany. You know, Bradley platoon leader. So I have, as a Bradley platoon leader, I have squads. I have machine gun teams. Had squads, fire teams, made up of fire teams. I had machine gun teams, and of course I had four, you know, incredibly lethal infantry fighting vehicles. So anyways, it's not the friendly side I'm talking about here. It's the Op 4. So they're at Hohenfels, maneuvering, you know, training against the Op 4. Just time and again, I saw the capacity of the Op 4 with their armored fighting vehicles was proven in my mind over and over again to be a function of the crews. If the crews, you know, I mean, if a crew isn't ready, a tank or a BMP is just a big hunk of metal, you know? I mean, there are all sorts of different ways to think about it and to model the crew inside the vehicle. And simply has to be modeled. What I'm getting at is that I had experiences of overrunning Op 4 mechanized units. So these are simulated BMPs and whatever T version of tank for the time, T-80s, I think, or T-72s, whatever. Overrunning them with dismounted infantry because we were where the Op 4 didn't think we were. And overrunning that Op 4 unit sitting on their vehicles was as easy. I mean, I'm exaggerating slightly, but it was as easy as wiping out, you know, an Op 4 unit that was sitting in a circle on the grass cleaning their weapons. I mean, the vehicles meant nothing in that contest because they didn't think or realize we were there. And that's what is so ingrained in my mind that, you know, a war game needs to factor in some things. Now, I understand there's all sorts of, you know, all sorts of approximations and, you know, design for effect and all that stuff. You know, all these, you know, special rules for infantry in close proximity to vehicles. But I don't want any of that approximation. I want it to be brought out that it is a contest between humans and humans, and perceptions and understanding and will. So anyways, I've certainly said enough on that for now, but not necessarily enough for all time. All right, so Iron Cross. Got a first interesting thing that I see here under the counters. Infantry, each infantry unit represents one man. Infantry units have the following information on them. Right away, we have infantry units are shown on the front side as being in an up position, and the back side of the counter is shown as represents the infantry unit, the individual infantryman, in a down position. Again, assuming that this is what I think it is, because they have a definition over here. Where is it? So unit states. All units will be in one of two combat states, up or down state. The front of a combat unit counter black print represents its up state, and the back white print the down state. No, that's not what I was talking about. Where is it? There it is. The front of infantry and crude weapon units is in black print, which represents an unconcealed, potentially vulnerable state, referred to in the rules as up. The back of the unit is in white print and represents a semi-concealed state, referred to in the rules as the down state. Also, the front of an AFV counter is in black print, representing its crew in an exposed or up state. The back of the counter is in white, representing its crew in a buttoned up or down state. This is, needless to say, to me, incredibly important to pretty much any game at the scale, at the squad scale and below. And incidentally, not to say it doesn't apply higher, because TCS has, and that's platoon scale, has essentially an up and a down position. They call it, you know, movement mode, combat mode, or whatever the terms are. You know, firing mode, movement mode, something like that. You know, movement mode, you are in TCS much more exposed. You're not going to return fire in any effective way. Conversely, when you're in the firing or down or whatever they call it, can't remember, mode, you maximize fire. You're obviously minimizing movement, but you're also maximizing your survivability. So that's even at the platoon scale. I think it's great that ATS includes that. You know, I wouldn't even consider that, like, for myself, mandatory at the platoon scale. The fact that ATS has it. I keep saying the wrong thing. Sorry, TCS, Tactical Combat Series. The fact that TCS has that is just a wonderful, you know, addition for me. But at pretty much scale, squad scale and below, you pretty much have to have this, and this is why. Several interrelated ideas here. Let's go back to you are in a concealed position, and you're looking out across, let's say, several hundred meters of, let's say, fields. So we're talking, if we go, squad scale, 50 meter hexes, we're talking 4 to 6 hexes. You're observing an opposing squad walking through the fields towards you. Walking towards you, even in formation spread out, even walking slowly and cautiously. In a field, they can be clearly visible. Even, and I think that, yes, we do factor in undulations in the ground, you're probably seeing at least half of a silhouette for each enemy soldier. At least half. We can guess here. Let's say 50% at least of each human-sized target figure outline is exposed. If you open up fire, you definitely have to account for, of course, rate of fire and at least rate of fire. But anyways, you open up fire, you need to cause casualties in that first moment of contact. So first moment of contact, you may get one or two casualties outright for this scale. and scope. After that, you know, the opposing squad goes to ground, and your ability, your acquisition of targets goes from 50% or better to maybe even 0%, like 0 to 10%. Huge difference. And for the time scale, it's important what the time scale is here, because if the time scale were stretched out to 15 minutes, it kind of disappears. The importance of this disappears, right? Because in 15 minutes, that squad can go, you know, up and down multiple times. Move up, down, return fire, blah, 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 blah. Tons of things, right? But when you go down to a time scale of 90 seconds or 2 minutes, let's get real. I mean, a squad could still go up or down several times, but in 2 minutes of contact, so let's go back, the squad's there walking across the fields, you open up fire, you hope, you want to cause casualties in that first moments of contact. About 2 minutes is when, so on your side, you've opened up fire, you've tried to hit as many targets as you can. You're going to follow up fire to try to move to suppression. You're going to try to move to suppression. You're going to try to assess the situation and try to figure out, did you cause any casualties, whatever. And probably about that's it for you on your side, 2 minutes. On the target side, seconds of contact. After seconds of contact, they're on the ground, but the leaders still have to assess the situation. If there are casualties within 2 minutes, maybe the unit is moving to adjust for the casualties, whatever that means. Maybe. I mean, that's really for a trained unit, actually. But okay, let's say that the squad's taken two casualties. One of those maybe is the squad automatic weapon, operator. So maybe within 2 minutes, the leaders are assessing the situation. They've ordered one soldier to crawl up and get the squad automatic weapon. The leaders have tried to assess where the enemy is, where the fire came from. They've started to give commands to return fire. Now, let's say if there were cover immediately, like within one or two bounds, also within 2 minutes, maybe, we can say the leaders have started to give orders for the soldiers to move to cover. Maybe all this happens in 2 minutes. But in any case, with these cycles, as I see it, the up and the down become critically important. Because again, if the target unit spends the next 2 minute cycle entirely in a down position, okay, in an entirely down position, well, this is militarily significant. This is in a tactical decision making sense. This is significant. Basically, what are you going to do? You now, as the side that basically opened up probably a hasty ambush here, what are you going to do? Because your ability, you know, just with the scope that we've defined here, the onus is now on you. What are you going to do? Because you're not going to cause that, the chance that you're going to cause any more casualties in this second 2 minute cycle have plummeted. So what are you going to do? So anyways, you can imagine all sorts of things of what you would do, but those things all need to be modeled to kind of, again, to roll this into, to roll these into terrain effects, you know, to roll these into the CRT and the combat results, probabilities and spreads. It's, no, I mean, plain and simple, I want the up and the down position because it is so, so, so significant to unit capabilities and decisions, decisions to make. You know, do you try to get your unit to go from down up to do something that you can do only in the up position, and vice versa. In some cases, vice versa. Okay, so the up and down is incredibly important, and I think that this is an excellent, by the way, this is an excellent use of two sides of a counter. Obviously, over the years, I guess, we've had probably the number one use of two sides of the counter is full strength and step loss. I think I've talked elsewhere where, maybe I haven't talked. It's a whole nother discussion why I personally want individual losses accounted for. This is not, whenever I say what I want, what I'm interested in, this is not to say that other ways of doing it are somehow inferior or anything. I've actually gone back and forth so let's take the squad scale, since that's probably, well, no, that is the, from squad scale and below, squad scale is the overwhelming majority that has been developed, right, in games. There isn't, I've thought back and forth about this a lot. There actually, it's perfectly acceptable, I think, to do step losses if the step losses, I can't even say that. Modeling squads or squad losses as a percentage of capability is fine. You know, there's something to be said for that. But the reason why I want individual losses is because I actually want to get to the point where which individual is lost makes a difference. But that gets way beyond, I think, Iron Cross. That gets into my ideas about modeling the individuals that make up a team and then the aggregate of the team. But anyways, that's another discussion. So, back to the two sides of a counter. I think the up and the down, because this is what should be, why is this the best use of front and back of a counter? Because again, at this scale, this should be what is changing the most. This, and I have to say it here, using the backside of a counter for a so-called broken state, whatever that represents and however that's implemented, having front unbroken, back broken, again, implying that in the scope of a scenario, again, supposed to be representing 10 to 15 minutes, the idea that the broken and unbroken is going to be moving back and forth enough to warrant the use of the front and the back of the counter, that just doesn't make any sense to me for several reasons. I'm not going to go into my discussion of morale again here. Excuse me, but I will give my slogan. There's not, units don't break. Units don't break at this scale. I understand what does breaking mean and connote, but even when I get an explanation for what breaking means, there are problems with it. Trying to figure out how to summarize my discussion on this. There is no good summary, but going into a 10 to 15 minute firefight, the assumption in my mind is always the both sides are going into that 10 to 15 minute firefight with a fairly high, well, this is actually morale, but a fairly high determination to survive, to kill or incapacitate the enemy, and to be victorious, period. I mean, if you're imagining a firefight where one side doesn't meet that basic criteria, it's obviously not, it's not an interesting encounter. And in any case, I don't even know why you would develop mechanics to represent a massacre, basically. But anyways. So this is what should be changing the most throughout the course of a 10 to 15 minute firefight, up and down. So use the counter's sides for this purpose. Okay, I like that. So what I'm saying, up and down is just critically important. By the way, the reason why, I'm sorry, not the reason, another reason why up and down is just critically important is because I would also like to see design go to the point where up and down affects the ability to fire. I mean, you don't have to fire a weapon in a military context, on a military range, more than a few minutes to realize there are firing positions you want to be in. You want to be in the prone. You want to be supported, like foxhole or whatever. So maybe this can be modeled. I mean, I'd like to see this possibly modeled. So the up and the down, I would like to see modeled the ability to, to generate firepower. It obviously influences survivability. And let's get to the point where up and down even influences your ability to see, your visibility. Visibility, is that right? Your ability to see. That gets interesting, because when you factor in at least those three, and maybe there's another one, maybe it influences the willpower of the unit. Maybe it influences the C2 ability. That becomes interesting, because you have to have real trade-offs, right? I mean, this is to all good games at this scale and scope present good, interesting tactical decisions, okay? It's just, again, which ones are included, which ones are focused on, right? For that scale and scope, squad and below, 10 to 15 minute firefight, the decisions to basically expose oneself to enemy action in order to return fire, I like to see all that. I would like to see all that modeled. And the up and the down is the basis for that, basically. So yeah, this would be interesting. Your unit is in an up position, moving. They have a certain ability to see. That unit goes to the down position. Ability to see is going to change. And when I was thinking about that the other day, I was thinking, you know, probably I should look at, I know it's an elaboration, but what would be interesting is to consider the idea of basically scanning versus focused sighting. There could be some interesting stuff done here. It could be as simple as units that are in the up position, maybe it's even in the up position moving, can only scan, and scanning has a certain rules function, right? Whereas in the down position or stationary, and or stationary, units can basically do, you know, focused sighting. That could be interesting, because that doesn't sound very complicated at all. Because we are already going to have something like TCS's sighting concept of how far away a certain target can be observed. So we could just have different values for maybe stationary and down. No, I'm sorry. Stationary and, yeah, I guess it's stationary and or down versus up and moving. So anyways, you can go on to model all sorts of differences between the up and the down. You can relate the up and the down to the terrain. You can relate up and down to obviously movement. By the way, this makes it, I think, this could make it so easy instead of having, it's getting a little frustrating, these small unit tactical games that go into so many different kinds of movement as separate rule blocks and mechanics. I mean, assault fire and blah, blah, blah. I mean, if you just have up and down and moving cautiously versus quickly, you have a 4x4 table, you could have everything covered. I mean, down and moving cautiously is crawling. Down and moving quickly is a kind of, well, it's a slow bounding. It's maybe bounding by individual. Up and moving cautiously could be something between bounding by buddy teams or fire teams, depending on your scale, and walking cautiously. And then, of course, up and moving quickly is running. Anyways, probably enough about that now. Next thing I notice is the infantry weapon types. Boy, there's a lot to talk about. This is actually what I was hoping would happen. Just looking at the Iron Cross rules is giving me tons to talk about, things that I already wanted to talk about. I see here, so the units, so you got your unit here, individual. So you have a, let's see what we got here. We have let's see, I've got the unit name. So in this case, the individual's name, lore. MP is the weapon type. That's what I was going to talk about next. Up here is the 2. That is the initial range, 2. B is just the squad or commander designation. Sorry. The 6 is the AP factor. 3 is the assault rating. And 10 is the performance rating. Already this is sounding interesting to me on multiple levels. But yeah, so the weapon type, the MP here. Got an MP. We have an R for rifle. We have LMG. LMG, light machine gun. Light machine gun. FT, flamethrower. And actually, those were the major types that I see listed here. So, what I want to do say about this is infantry weapon types by letter. So basically, letter code. So what it tells you here is that the German rifle, what the rules are telling you is that the German rifle represents the German Gewehr K98K 7.92 millimeter bolt action rifle, whereas R on the Russian unit represents the 7.62 millimeter bolt action rifle. So, and then it goes right down the line. So the MP for the Russian represents the PPSH 41 7.62 millimeter machine pistol, whereas MP on the German represents the, so Eckelmann is carrying a German MP 49 millimeter machine pistol. So what I like about this already is that basically the classes of weapons. That's all I'm going to be looking at, because basically you're talking range, rate of fire, but also killing power. So whatever ballistic characteristic that's related to. I'm no expert on this stuff. Yeah, the killing power. So if certain weapons really did were notorious for, you know, hitting targets but not fully incapacitating them. If that's significant, I would want that factored in, but not individual, you know, weapon names and stuff like that. I want classes of weapons represented so that basically if one side is primarily or exclusively bolt action rifle equipped and the other side is predominantly, we'll say, you know, machine pistol or assault rifle equipped, there's some, you know, that's factored into combat results. Then we have AFVs. So we have a Panzer 4F2. So I guess the one up here, I think is the ID number. I say think because that doesn't really correspond exactly to the example given here, but it must be the ID number. 5 over here is the AP initial range. The 4 here is the frontal modifier. The 3 is the flank modifier. 10 is, performance rating. 8 is the overrun factor, 18 is the AP factor, and 11 is the AT factor. And then obviously the name, that's quite a bit of information. Interesting. The AFV types included in this game, Iron Cross, are on the Russian side, BT-7Ms, T-32As, T-34-76A, in parentheses, T-34B, T-34-76B, in parentheses, KV-1A, T-26Ss. No expert on my World War II AFVs either. On the German side, we have 2Ds, Panzerkampfwagen 2D, Panzerkampfwagen 3E and 3Js, 4Ds and F2. Yeah, okay, 4Ds and 4F2s, Stug 3Bs, Stug 3Bs, that's it. And then we have the Cruiser weapon. Let's see if I can get a good one. Take this. AT, so it says 37AT. I guess 1 is the ID number again, 5, AP initial range again. Crew size, the 4 is the crew size, 0 is the movement factor. 9 again is performance rating, 1 is assault factor, 8 is AP factor. Oh, and the 7 is what? What's the 7? Oh, that, obviously that's the AT factor, like the tank, like the AFV. And these represent the weapon and the number of men required to operate it. So this 37AT gun has a crew of 4. So crewed weapon types, medium machine guns. We have the Russian Maxim PM910 medium machine gun and the German MG34 tripod mounted machine gun. ATRs, we have the Russian PTRS-41 anti-tank rifle and the German PZB-39 anti-tank rifle. We have on the mortar side, we have the Russian 50mm PM40 mortar and the German 50mm LEGR W36 mortar. Then we have the 45 AT gun, 76 AT gun, 37 AT gun with different national weapon systems. Yeah, interesting. So we have a crew ammo roster. This roster is used to keep track of crewed weapon unit crew strengths, crew replacements, grenade availability, ammo supply, and machine gun modes. Copies should be made before play. So they're referring to this one. All right, unit states, this is the up and the down. So you have up and down, the unit, again, the black writing, black, unit information, the white unit information on the back for the down position. Then we have a unit can also be normal, pinned, or suppressed states. Call them morale states here. Statuses. So we have P and S markers for that. P and S markers there. So combat states. A unit in the up state retains its full movement and fire capabilities, while a unit in the down state is subject to movement and fire limitations. So they do factor in fire capability changes for being up or down. A unit may start the game or enter the map in either state. Normal state status units may change their combat states voluntarily during their movement and reaction movement phases at a cost in movement points. Cost in movement points. This game has an interesting combined movement and combat effects table, which is two-thirds of a page. So what are we looking at? We have the type and level. Type and level, movement point cost, infantry up. Oh, infantry and crude weapon up, infantry and crude weapon down. So there are different movement, which there should be. Yeah, even the AFVs, even the armored fighting vehicles have difference in up or down. The crew is exposed. They can move more easy because they can see better. Buttoned up, yeah. Now, of course, another game might just simply have a buttoned up, you know, movement point penalty. But I like at least the suggestion. I don't know if it's going to bear out, but the suggestion that the focus here is on the crew. Again, you talk if the rules only talk about a buttoned-up vehicle, this is a very slight concept, but the focus is on the hunk of metal. You know, if you have up or down AFE, clearly the focus is on the crew. So I'll see how much that bears out. Number of AP combat dice. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, none, +1, +1, +1, +1 die per IP. Improved position, okay. AP firepower modifier. And observe base. 10, 10, 7, 6, 5, 9, 8. Yeah. I should, I want to say, well, nothing really to discuss here yet, but observation, and I've already talked a little bit about observation in the sense of ability to see. Observation, again, it's a scale thing, right? Obviously, it's a scale thing. But I do want to emphasize. Obviously, it's a scale thing, but I still want to emphasize that it's a scale thing. Observation should, at this scale, never be some type of automatic mechanic. Or at least in the vast majority of cases. Bottom line, of course, two small units going up against each other, going into a fight with the willpower to fight and survive, the willpower to survive, the willpower to fight, the belief that they can prevail, all of that stuff means to me that each side is doing its utmost to not be just observed willy-nilly, right? So the point is, at this scale and scope, observation should be something that you actively have to do in some way, shape, or form. Enough on that. But some games, there are games out there that I have at least come across. I can't say I have extensive experience playing them yet, but I have run across some that actually have a visibility mechanic, an observation mechanic, where you have to compute whether you see something or not in some way, shape, or form. And I'm not just talking about a table at this scale and scope. One idea, and this is kind of an idea that just kicking around in my head, is that, and yes, it's extra mechanic, got it, but a unit uses observation points and spends observation points to see through hexes according to terrain, like you move through terrain. Okay, at least one game I know of uses this, so I like it. Now, what I want to do is I want to add, I don't think the game that I'm thinking of has this thing, so I like that idea. As a matter of fact, I might even just take that lock, stock, and barrel. Here's the difference, though. If your unit, for example, has 10 observation points, and the unit is spending observation points to see through different types of terrain according to a table, basically if you're well short of your limit, then you either, if you're well short of your limit allowance, let's say there's an observation allowance, if you're well short, you see the target. And if you're well beyond your limit, you just don't see it. But if you're in a range above or below your allowance, then you roll. So there is some variability. I mean, I'm looking out my window right now. I'm looking over probably, 150 meters? 150 meters, I'm looking out my window. I'm looking at, there's trees definitely obscure, probably about 50% of my sight. So 150 meters away, there's a house. 150 meters away, there's a house. For me to see a unit, whether it's a fire team or a squad, let's say in that house, because there are some windows that are facing me. It's a two-story house. So trees are, let's say, along my line of sight, but not obscuring the house. And there are other houses along my line of sight that is obscuring some of my vision. As a matter of fact, half of the house, I'll just round off and say half of the house is obscured by other houses. Okay. All of this can be, well, we also have to take atmospherics and lighting into factor those in as well. So it's a clear blue sky day. So it's clear atmospherics. So this would be an example, I think, and of what I'm talking about, of whether I see that unit in that house through those windows, or maybe at the base of the house, outside maybe. Although I should say that at this scale, you also have to factor in inside and outside and a couple other things. But anyways, I wasn't going to go there now, so set that aside. For me to observe the unit there, it's variable, right? It's a variable like whether I'm actively looking there at the same time that the unit exposes itself to observation in the windows, around the base of the building, whatever. There's a probability, right? A chance. So it's whatever that is. So that's what I'm rolling for. That makes perfect sense to me. Whereas if I come forward, if I move an enemy unit over 100 meters towards me, so now it's within 50 meters away, so let's say one hex away, that would put them in either that puts them in plain level grass. And I can say there would be no question, I would see the squad there, or unit, whatever the unit is. I would see the unit there. I would probably see, I'm looking here, with some obstructions, some bushes, some other cars. I mean, I may see 75% or more of that unit. So that's what I mean by a sighting mechanic, where you spend points to see through terrain. And remember, this is a standalone video. I have talked before about how I want my terrain to be individual hexes that have individual characteristics. I talked about, I guess I am referencing that earlier discussion, but it goes without saying that I throw out the concept at this scale and scope, there are no clear hexes, woods hexes, building hexes. Everything has all sorts of different terrain on it. Each hex being whatever, 15 meters, 25 meters, 40 meters, 50 meters, whatever. That area has different characteristics about it. And one of them is basically its visibility, observability, obscuration, whatever you want to call it, I was thinking about the ability to see through that hex, and it's a different value, right? 10%, 40%, 90%, like a really thick woods might be 100%. You're not seeing through it at all, or is that 0%? However you want. Well, let's talk about percentage of observation through. So a thick woods might be 0%. Whereas this urban, that's not urban, this suburban area that I'm looking at out my window, some hexes here that I'm looking at would be like 50%. Again, visibility through it. There are cars, there are fences, there are bushes, there are some smaller houses. So with that individuality of terrain, then it becomes even more relevant that you would spend observation points to see through hexes. And again, if you're near your maximum allowance, then you would roll for some variability. The last thing to say about that I can't even remember. I can't remember. So where was I? Where was I with Iron Cross? Morale status, pinned and suppressed. Oh yeah. Performance. This is a separate rules section. Each combat unit has a performance rating. So again, the 9, the 8, and the 10. So all these guys have different individual performance ratings. Okay, so each time a unit attempts to perform certain game functions, it must make a performance check. Whenever a PC, platoon commander, I think. Performance check is required. Two dice are rolled and added together. This total is occasionally modified. If the result is less than or equal to the PR of the unit in question, the PC has been passed. This is what I was thinking. This might add a tiny, tiny bit. I don't think it's going to be overwhelming. Again, this will all come out when I play this in detail, but this adds a tiny bit of RPG aspect to the game, which incidentally, not only do I not have an issue with, a lot of RPG mechanics lend themselves significantly to a hex encounter game at this scale. Only if the PC is passed can the unit perform the action desired. If the PC is not passed, the unit cannot perform the action and cannot do anything else in that phase. Very important. Anytime a unit takes a PC, regardless of the result, it is considered to have performed that action. In the balance of these rules, rather than constantly repeating the phrase move or have attempted to move, when referring to a unit, the terms move, fire, and assault will refer to units that have taken a PC for the action, regardless of the outcome of the PC, pass or fail, and the action of the unit. Example, a player wants to move his unit X, but it fails its PC. The unit is considered to have moved for the remainder of that player turn. Okay, very important. Summary of PC types, regular PCs, two dice rolled, results added together. Movement, fire combat, indirect fire, indirect mortar fire observation. Modified PCs, same as regular PC, but a number is added to the result. Circumstances, morale recovery, leader-directed movement, opportunity fire, grenade attacks, assault. I'm going to wrap this video up just for time considerations, I guess, but definitely see some really interesting things in these Iron Cross rules.